quarter I should have dualized. So second thing I am doing, I am dualizing for the delay, which was beyond my control. I am thankful to Jaipur Institute, especially to Dr. Murad for inviting me. As you have seen from my profile, this was a very regular feature when I was in SEBI. So there is slight threat. So it has become not so frequent when I am being invited. So I am thankful to Dr. Murad for inviting me. And I am thankful to whole management of the institute. Dear students, faculty members, co-panelists. First slide, I should not say anything because Dr. Thakur has given the best possible introduction to the topic about the role of the intermediaries, what is expected from them, why they are necessary, and the people or the students who wants to pursue that career, what they should know before entering into that field. As you know, I am from SEBI, so I will be basically touching upon the SEBI requirement, and now I am handling the commodity derivative markets also. So briefly I will be touching the Forward Contract Regulation Act also, which is being regulated by Forward Market Commission, that is FMC. So as you all are aware, SEBI is the regulator of the securities market, and the Forward Market Commission is the regulator of the commodities derivative market. There is difference because generally people say commodities market. It is not correct. This commodity market is, we are being regulated by so many regulators like APMCs, Agriculture Produce Marketing Committees of the different states. So the derivative product of those commodities, I think you are the management students, you might be aware of the derivatives. Otherwise, I will tell you in very brief. As I have been instructed, I will be very, try to be very simple. I will speak with you in layman's language. So commodity derivative, if somebody doesn't know, derivative means there has to be some, like there are shares, for example, shares of so many companies. The companies which are dealing in automobile industries. So there could be a derivative product of the shares of all automobile companies which are listed in the securities market. As you would have heard, Nifty. Nifty is the bunch of the shares of 50 top companies which has been selected by the National Stock Exchange. And the movement, cumulative movement of those 50 shares indicates the movement of Nifty. Sensex. Sensex is the bunch of, I think, 200 companies selected as per some criteria devised by BSE, which has been made available to the public. So they have selected 200 companies which are representing all the sectors of the market. So the movement, cumulative movement of those 200 shares up or down gives the indication Sensex has gone up or Sensex has gone down. So Sensex itself is a derivative. Often underlying, what is underlying? Underlying is the shares of those companies which are in that bunch. Similarly, commodity derivatives, there are commodities like Gehu. What would be the price of Gehu after 6 months? Nobody is buying Gehu or selling Gehu. They are only indicative prices, and on that basis the trades are taking place, but the delivery is ensured if the trades have happened through the recognized associations. So after 6 months, if somebody wants to sell that product, he need not be the delivery of the Gehu, he can only hand over the receipt that way. So as far as the securities, if somebody is more interested, because this FMC, Forward Contract Regulation Act, was passed in long back in 1952. And at that point of time, FMC, which has been constituted as a regulator of that market, was not envisaged to be become like a SEBI, which has become in 1992. So it was established as a part of the Ministry of the Consumer Affairs at that point of time. So there was no concept of regulation making in the forward contract regulation. It was just like a government department, which used to happen in the case of floating market also. Before 1992, there was a department within the Ministry of Finance, which was the controller and capital issue, which used to decide who will come with the public issue, what would be the price of the public issue. They only used to verify the details, whether the proper disclosures are there, whether the company deserves to be given the authority to come out of the public issue, what would be the quantity of the shares, what would be the price of the shares. Same way, this regulator was established. In 1992, when we have adopted this, opened our economy and adopted this economic liberalization, SEBI was established as a statutory body. And we have adopted, earlier this was a control, like as the name, very name suggests, controller of capital issue. Now we have established this body as a regulator. There is a huge difference between the regulator and the controller. I think you might have heard from your parents, around 30 years back, if you wanted to buy a scooter, you have to book. A girl was born in the family, they used to book a Priya scooter with the expectation that after 20 years, when she will be of the marriageable age, they will get the delivery. So a scooter will be given as a gift. That was the state of the affairs of the government and governance. Even the cement was not available, even the sugar was not available in the open market. Everything was controlled by the government. Subsequently, when this was opened up, so the concept was introduced that the government or government body will regulate the market. It will not control the market. Let the market forces decide what should be the price, whether you want to buy this product, I have come with this product, I want to sell this in 10 rupees, and I will tell you what are the benefits, what are the good qualities of this pen. If you are interested, you can buy. And government will not interfere in that. What government will interfere only is that you will not make a false disclosure about this. And you have not obtained this metal from illegal means. Somebody should be there to check this is not a stolen good. And you have followed all the procedures, you have taken all the licenses, etc. You have the electricity in your factory, which is proper, which is not through Katia. And you sell this product and somebody is interested, he will buy. So from the control, we have adopted the disclosure, which we say we call disclosure-based regime. To disclose everything, even you have committed a crime, even you have committed a murder, the promoter has committed a murder, and the company wants to come out with a public issue, there is no problem. You come out with a public issue, but you must disclose that this is the criminal case pending against XYZ, who is the in charge of the company. But these are the cases pending which have the financial implications. These are the violations which have been held against me in past. These are under litigation. And this is my factory, this is the project. From this place I am taking the technology, from this place I am taking the machine. These are my key managerial persons. And then let the investor take well-informed investment decision. That is the crux of the disclosure-based regime. You disclose everything, and then you take, if somebody is interested, government is not going to tell that I am approving this. That is why SEBI never approves any offer documents. It only vets. There's a difference. Approval means I have approved, I have seen every fact, and I approve that everything is correct. That is impossible to be done. So who will do that? First of all, SEBI will never do that. SEBI only vets. Yes, I have specified 100 requirements that you will disclose 100 things, you have disclosed or not, I see you have disclosed. But who will confirm that the disclosures are true. First responsibility of the issuer under the Companies Act, Old Companies Act, Section 63. No misstatements. If the misstatement has been made, then you are liable to be prosecuted. Second, here comes the role of intermediary. Because I am a company, I want to establish a project which is of 200 crore rupees. I am having 20 crore. I will go to my friends, relatives, and associates. I will gather around 50 crore rupees. Then I will go to bank. The cost of borrowing the money is too high. So I will take some money from there. Then I will go to public and I will sell this idea of this project or this pen, that this pen is going to sell like a hot cake. If you invest in this, there is a likelihood, and these are the disclosures, and there is a likelihood that within 2 years or 3 years you will earn more than what you will earn through the normal investment methods. So I, as a company, I can't go to everybody. So I will engage an intermediary. And who that intermediary would be? Lead manager or merchant banker. That is called lead manager or merchant banker. The intermediary, namely lead manager or merchant banker, is a registered business. I think I am going without referring to my PPT. So this is only for the academic purposes. You can share if you want between all of you. So SEBI, I will come on that also. SEBI was established in 92 with these three main objectives: protection of the interest of investors, development of the securities market, and regulation of the securities market. And as for the SEBI Act, no intermediary can act as such without registration. So this lead manager is an intermediary, and he cannot act as a lead manager without taking registration. Why? This is an investor protection measure. This is the first objective. First, this is the soul of the SEBI Act, investor protection. And then we were recruited in 1996. We were told in the very first meeting with the chairman that whatever you do in SEBI, because sometimes this regulation, investor protection and development, there is many situations that there will be conflict. If you want to stop somebody, there will be a conflict vis-a-vis the development aspect. If you say you don't do this, this will hamper the development. But even it hampers the development, you have to first protect the interest of investors. You have to ensure that investors' interest is protected, then anything can happen. So the language of the provision, if you see SEBI intermediary regulations, the requirement is that no intermediary can act as an intermediary without seeking the registration, which has to be obtained in accordance with the regulations made by SEBI. And regulation provide for rules of the game, such as all these. These are only academic things, I am not going to. I will be only telling you the general things. So lead manager takes the responsibility of preparing the offer document, wherein he has to comply with all the SEBI requirements, give all the details, and it is his responsibility to ensure that all the correct facts, figures are mentioned. Now the most of the issues are coming through Brookfield building process. If in short we can say that now it is an open market, like I want to sell this pen, I want to sell this at 20 rupees. If you want to buy it, I have to justify this is 20 rupees if you want to buy it. After listening my justification, it's okay. So I have to market as a lead manager. I will market this. How company will fix the price of the issue? Because share face value will be 10 rupees, but company wants to sell this at 300 rupees. Then company has to justify why it is charging a premium of 290 rupees. For that, it has to justify. For that, lead manager do the roadshow, they justify, they go here and there, they involve the institutional investors, they involve the anchor investors, they sell this product, they sell the idea, and then on that basis, average price is arrived at, that that though the face value of this is 10 rupees, but there is a demand for this at 290 rupees, as against 300, which was only was expecting. So this will come as a 290 rupees. So 10 rupees face value and 280 will be the premium amount. Lead manager then appoints, in consultation with the company, the merchant banker to the issue. Because when the issue will open, money will come. So as per the requirement of the law, money will not go directly to the company because company is a private entity. So scheduled bank, commercial bank, all they have been allowed to be become a merchant banker to the issue. Money will go to them. They will deposit all the money collected, application money, in escrow account. And once they see that all the requirements, other requirements are fulfilled, shares have been allowed to be listed in the stock exchanges, listing will take place on that particular day. Then allotment will be made by the lead manager in consultation with the registrar and company. All the shares will be allotted and excess money will be refunded back to the investor. These are all responsibilities of the lead manager and company. And as far as the money component is concerned, it is the banker to the issue which acts as a trustee of the investors. So his responsibility is that all the allotment money after the allotment goes to company and the remaining is refunded back to the investor. I will tell you very interesting case which will sum up my SEBI's requirement as a what is expected from an intermediary. There was a bank. This is an old case. There was a bank. Banker to the issue. Public issue came, and as per section 73, please note down, you please read it. 73 is very interesting, old 1956 Companies Act. 73 provision, which says that a company can apply for a listing in one or more stock exchanges, and if the permission of listing is granted, then only money will go to the company and company, the issue goes through. If the permission is not granted by all the stock exchanges, the language is all the stock exchanges, issue fails and money has to be refunded. In this case, what happened? The company applied for listing in Ahmedabad Stock Exchange and Bombay Stock Exchange. Ahmedabad Stock Exchange gave the permission, Bombay Stock did not give. And it was a scheduled bank, nationalized bank. What they did without confirming, without verifying whether the listing is there or not, moment the money or issue closes, all the money comes, they transfer the money to the company. So action against company was taken subsequently because the listing was not granted, but the action was also taken against the merchant banker to the issue. And they said, I have nothing to do with that. I am only collecting the money as an agent of the issuer company. And my responsibility is only collecting and giving it to the issuer. It is the responsibility of the issuer who has taken the money. SEBI held, which was upheld by the Securities Appellate Tribunal subsequently, that no, apart from acting as an agent of the company, you are also acting as a trustee of the investor's money. They have given the money to you, and why this provision has been made? Otherwise, the provision could have been that you give the money to the company directly by your demand draft or check in the name of XYZ and company. Why it has been given to XYZ bank? Because you are the registered intermediary and you are expected to exercise due diligence in your functioning, it was your responsibility to check whether the person, and you are, and that particular bank was has acted as a banker to the issue and so many other issues also previously, and that was a nationalized bank. So the view was taken, which was upheld by SAT, that no, it was not expected of you, as you are an intermediary, you are expected to behave responsibly. And we have like a trustee in a fiduciary capacity, you are holding the money of the investor, and you should have checked and you should have verified before transferring the money to the issuer company. This is in some substance, this is the expectation from the internet. My presentation would be there on your system. Anybody is interested can go ahead. I think I have lost my time, so I will close here and I will be happy to participate in the question answer session. Before closing, one more thing I want to tell as SEBI, because SEBI has launched 3-4 years back a nationwide investor education and financial literacy program. I have gone to so many institutes, not only in Delhi, but in Nagpur. So this is my invitation to your institute. Anybody, any group of 50 persons, whenever they are ready on any topic, general or specific, they can approach SEBI either to me or I will give the email address and other details to Dr. Amra. Whenever you are ready for academic exercise or general knowledge, 30-40 people are in there, SEBI people will come, or SEBI authorized resource person will come and impart the education. Thank you.
Thanks, Mamsa, for sharing your views. Now I would like to request Dr. Amit Bagga to come on the podium and express his views.
It's been a pleasure to interact at Jaipuria with the speech managers. Respected Director Sir, faculty members and my dear students. I will thank Professor Rao Sir that he has given this opportunity to interact with you particularly on this topic of financial markets and intermediaries. Now in this first topic I'd like to explain you what exactly is the role of financial intermediary and how do they work as far as their governance part is concerned. And then I'll be coming to the new innovative topics of financial intermediaries, and then thirdly I'll be focusing on the audit aspects of the financial intermediaries. Because I am basically from the audit side, where we have been given a lot of audits from SEBI as well as from RBI to interact with the banks and particularly with the mutual funds, where we need to see that whether their governance is being done properly or not. Right. So first of all, I like to explain you that the financial intermediary is basically the tool with the help of which we are able to mobilize the funds and we are able to get the funds invested in the market. As you can see in this flowchart, it's a very simple concept that they are the suppliers of the fund and then they are the demanders. You know, the demand is being done from the industry people and the supply of the money is given by the retail investors or even by the corporates, the people who are able to cope up with the funds and then the people who are basically demanding. So the role of intermediary is very important because they are the people who are basically in between the two set of organizations or the suppliers and the demand, and then they get the money channelized from one set to the another part. So that's basically what exactly the financial intermediary is all about. And I believe Mr. Praveen has already given you a brief idea about the SEBI as a regulator. I'll be focusing on some of those regulators as well. Like we have the banks, you know, we have NBFCs, we have mutual funds, and we have insurance companies who are basically working as a financial intermediaries as far as the Indian markets are concerned. And you are aware of this fact that the sector is being growing very high, and Indian markets, you know, are working on the financial side so that you can get more funds mobilized and you can get the money invested in the you know, manufacturing side or in the real estate side as well as on the construction side. So the idea is very simple, that the financial intermediary is providing you the four different aspects of services, and these services are broadly, they're giving you the convenience as far as the fund raising is concerned, then they're giving you the low risk profile because there's a regulator and the regulator is able to mop up the funds and they're able to diversify the risk, as we can see in the case of mutual funds. Then the third is there is an expert management in the financial intermediary who is basically able to manage the things very properly with the help of the regulators. And then finally, you know, they are going to have the economies of scale as well, right? Because you can see if we have a good intermediary, the costing goes down and the things have been able to manage very properly. That's one of the basic aspects of the financial intermediary. That's the first part, I believe. When Director Sir has given a wonderful speech when he explained about what is the role of financial intermediary, and it's not a new concept today in the Indian market. Even when we talk about the barter system, you know, way back since the dawn of the economy, we have been discussing about this concept of financial intermediary. Earlier it was not on the monetary side, it was more of a barter system. Today it is more on the monetary side, where you have a regulator like SEBI and RBI who are basically managing this part. Now, something which is really interesting is that basically the financial intermediary is raising the money from the public at large, and we have the different roles of the intermediary today in the market. When we talk about the intermediaries, we have merchant bankers, we have stock brokers, we have underwriters, we have transfer agents, and we have depository participants. And these intermediaries are basically working in different perspective when we talk about mutual fund services, we talk about portfolio management, we talk about CRISIL, ICRA type of rating agencies and VCs and the different financiers who are working as investment bankers as well. So these intermediaries are helping us to mobilize the fund for the corporate side so that the economy can grow. Now, I have one basic example of Unicorn Financial Intermediary for whom we are doing some audits as well. So they are basically providing you the facilities on different fronts. They are basically into fixed income, which is banking aspect. They are into wealth management. They are into commodity side. They are into real estate. They are into securities and financial securities as well. So, first of all, as a role of financial intermediary, I believe till now everybody is very much crystal clear that the financial intermediary is basically helping to mobilize the funds and to be invested in the markets. Now I am focusing on some of the innovative aspects of financial intermediary as far as the Indian markets are concerned, because today we are talking about CDR, we talk about the corporate debt restructuring, which is a new innovative product, but that's the changing role of a financial intermediary. Because what happens today in the corporate world, you are talking about the increase in the NPA levels. So the level of the NPA increases because there is a default by the client side. So what the banks are coming across with is that they are trying to do the restructuring of the debt part so that the level of NPA is being reduced and we can get some more time as far as the repayment clause is concerned. For example, we have the case of Suzlon, we have a case of a DLF, we have so many companies who have been applying for the CDR part, where the companies have raised money and their interest rate might be higher, and now they are requesting those banks and those institutions to revise the interest rate and to give them a lower interest rate or a fresh loan so that they can manage the things easily. So that's one aspect we have. And then we have asset reconstructions, we have CDS. CDS, one deal has got stuck in India, and the credit default swap says that we are getting our debtors insured. So even in the bank's balance sheet, which sir will be taking, Rajneesh sir will be taking in detail, that what happens in the bank, the debtors are the defaulters, and the risk enters in the balance sheet from the asset side, right? So if those asset side are basically insured, which is in the form of a CDS, then automatically the risk will be reduced in the bank balance sheet. So we are talking about, as a new innovative product in financial intermediaries, that talks about the CDS concept, which is credit default swaps, right? In which we will be insuring the debtors of the bank. So once the bank insures their debtors, automatically default will reduce and the risk will be less. So we are talking about the risk management as well, as far as the innovative product of financial intermediary is there. Now what will we do when we talk about the CDR and why we are asking for a CDR aspect as far as the Indian markets are concerned? You know, the concept is very simple, that whenever the corporate who has borrowed the money from a bank and he is not in a position to make the repayments, might be because interest rates are too high in India as compared to when you compare it with China, the China interest rate is 1.5% or 2%. But when we talk about an Indian interest rate, it goes to 12.5%, 30%, 40% rate. So what happens in that case, that sometimes there are defaulters. So what they do is they request the bank to do a CDR for them. Now CDR is basically means that you are doing a restructuring of your debt part so that automatically your risk will be reduced and you will be getting a new loan or a fresh loan at a lower interest rate, or your existing loan will be reduced at the interest rate part. So that is what is the important part. And we have a big size of CDR market in India because the restructuring is happening as far as the financial side is concerned, and we are trying to manage and reduce the level of risk, which is broadly the NPA levels. Now, there is one of the news given by the Reuters which says that almost every 1 rupee which is being lent to the Indian markets, 13 paisa is being moving towards the NPA levels, right? So that is which is very high. That means 30% of rupee 1 will be going towards that level, so that means the risk will be high. So we want a strong intermediary and a strong regulator who can manage this part and can reduce the level of the default risk. So that is what we are focusing on. Because if you can see, the size of the CDR has been increasing. Now this is something which we need to understand, that if the size of CDR increases, that means that there is a possibility of a default. Because the company going for a CDR broadly means that there is a risk appetite on the funding side or on the borrowing side, and the repayment is getting a problem, and that's why we want these levels to be reduced, and we want that the corporate should be able to pay off their debts in time and with a proper interest rate, and they should not generally go for the CDR, because going with CDR basically means that there is a default risk which is basically arising as far as the corporates are concerned. So as a financial intermediary, which is a bank, they must see that no such type of, you know, consequences should be done in future. As we have come across with the latest news of Bhushan Steel or with the case of Kingfisher Airlines, where the companies have been defaulting and the bank's money is basically at risk. And from where the bank has taken that money? From retail investors or from those industry who have actually deposited their money, and that's how the risk is increasing. So we want that this risk should be reduced as far as the repayment part is concerned. Now, there are certain lacunas which we generally see in our audit. That's what is my role when I go to RBI or to SEBI for an audit part. They want us to focus particularly on the functions of those intermediaries, that they should function in an effective way and they should not get into any type of deals which are being shown here, like money laundering is one aspect, or DABA trade, or national spot exchange, which is a scam on the commodity side itself. Then the bribery case of Bhushan Steel, or when we talk about insider trading. So this is what we are doing on the behalf of the SEBI as well as the RBI, when they appoint us as an auditor, to check that there should not be any type of, you know, lacunas or any type of gray areas as far as these intermediaries are concerned. Because what happens many a times, you know, they try to manipulate in a way to get more business. Or sometimes the bank says that they have been pressurized to achieve the targets. So in order to achieve the targets, in even in case if they don't have the proper documentation, they do open the accounts, or even with the KYC is there very much, right? I believe everybody know about KYC. Even with KYC now, there is the cases of money laundering where the individual money is being transferred to the banks. And that's a three-layer structure as far as the money laundering is concerned. Now how money laundering happens, that there is a placement of money at the first level, and then there is a layering part, and then there is an integration part. So let me give you a very basic example which I have come across in my audit part on the money laundering, where illegal money is being transferred to a bank account. How to manage it? So this is how they do it. They open a restaurant, right, which is a very legalized source of, you know, doing a business, and they deposit the proceeds of their drug business, right, via restaurant, because in restaurant you are getting most of the cash receipts. So when you receive cash and your business is not so great, but what do you tell them, that I am doing a restaurant and I am getting a lot of cash receipts, so I am depositing the money of my restaurant daily sales. But actually it is not that, it is basically the money which you are getting either from some terrorist group, or either you are getting that money from some of those drug buying business which is illegal activity, and you don't mind paying taxes as well in that case, right? When you talk about a money laundering deal and the illegal transfer or dirty money getting cleaned in the market, it is basically done with the help of this money laundering. So here we need to be very particular as a financial intermediary, that we should stop these type of activities. Because recently you might have seen there was a news and says that the black money is being pumped in the Indian economy, and financial intermediaries are playing a very vital role to facilitate those activities, because they are achieving their targets as well. So in order to achieve their targets, they are basically facilitating these type of deals as well, and that's how the money is being poured to the Indian markets. So we have the gray area part is that the politicians, banks and the corporates. We have seen in an audit that with improper documentation, a bank is opening the account because it is a politician money, and he wants that money to be opened in different benami transactions. So we have a lot of benami transactions still persist in India, even with strong regulators, and the money is being transferred and given to the banks, and that's how the money is being manipulated as far as the money laundering aspect is concerned. And that's one of the aspects which picture shows, that dirty money comes to the bank and it is being transferred to the offshore accounts, and then again it is transferred from one country to another country, and it is being transferred as clean money. So a dirty money is being processed into clean money, but here the role of intermediary is very important. Because intermediary is in between, who has to check the and to manage the control. But sometimes they do it because they are getting good business, because they are getting good volumes, and they are the people who are even facilitating diseases bring. So that is what we need to understand. And there has been a news as well on sale in IBM that money laundering is being done by HDFC Bank, and top notch banks have been involved in the money laundering deal as well as Indian markets are concerned. Now, that's why the regulator, when we talk about this, the RBI, they have introduced that you have to prove yourself, and you have to basically confirm yourself whether you are fulfilled with your KYC norms or not. And even if you have to do it, you have to recheck it, and you have to again go to the bank in person whether the regulations have been properly complied with or not. So that's something which is really important in order to prevent a money laundering. RBI as a regulator is doing the best of its own. They have appointed chartered accountants and the institutes, because I am being working with NCA as well, where we are doing some forensic audits as well, so that there should not be any such type of deals happen with the banks. But still we have seen that banks are engaged in these types of deals as far as the money transfers is concerned. As far as the penalty part is concerned, the regulator is penalizing most of the banks for such type of deals as far as the money moves in the market, and so many banks have been sentenced and given notices on the money laundering fraudulent activity. Now, coming to the next important aspect of the financial intermediary, which is a one of the most happening concepts in the Indian market, whether it is a commodity market or equity market, when we get into a dabba trade. Now, what happens in a dabba trade, I become myself as a SEBI, I become a regulator, and the two people who are coming to me as a buyer and as a seller, and I try to manipulate both the buyers and sellers of my own as if that I will not get the trade moved to the stock market, and I will buy and sell on the common behalf of the seller and the buyer. That's what we do in a dabba trading system. So we must stop these type of activities as far as this type of transactions are concerned when we talk about this dabba trading, because in this you are working as a regulator and you don't let the trade get entered into the markets. So you become the market, or as a regulator, as SEBI, as a main broker, and the two people coming to you, you get the deal negotiated between the two people, and you don't let the trade happen to the stock exchange. That's what is a dabba trade. So SEBI has come heavily on this, that to stop this dabba trade, but the citizens or the people of India, they ask for this. This is what we have come across. Because my company is also a sub-broker, and a lot of clients ask us that we want to trade, but we want to trade in black. We don't want to disclose. So can you give me a rate for gold, or can you give me a rate for a company trading like Reliance without executed on SEBI? So that is what is the purpose. When you clients are, when the clients are asking for a dabba trade, and we are getting some commission on the same, so sometimes it happens that a financial intermediary is willful, trying to manipulate these type of activities. So that's one dabba trade. And then we have another application which is very much happening in the Indian markets as well, when we talk about insider trading activities. And I believe everybody understands about insider trading, and when the news is being shared with some of those closely held people of the company, and then you take the advantage of that news and you take a short position or a long position, whether in derivatives or in the stock market. And in this case, it has been seen that regulator can do something only when he is aware of that fact that this dabba trade is, insider trading is being happening. If he is not aware of those fact that sudden news is being leaked by Mukesh Ambani about his company to his friends, and his fellow friends have done a lot of trade in the stock market, so then even the regulator is helpful, he is basically helpless, and he cannot manage this type of deal as well. So insider trading is very much there in the Indian market as well, and you must be aware of that fact. In US, Rajat Gupta is being sentenced because of this insider trading. And then we have the scam on the commodity markets itself, which is basically Jignesh and Anjani Sinha, in which what has been done, that the National Agriculture Cooperative Federation of India, which is NAFED, they increase the days of the transaction. A transaction which is to be settled in T plus 10 days or T plus 2 days have been increased to T plus 35 days. So what happens is, when you are giving that much of the gap, there is a scope of speculative activities and arbitrage between the spot market and the derivatives market. So that's something which is going wrong, because this is not being regulated even by SMC. And that's why it happened, because if the regulator is silent in some of the trades, then you can manipulate very easily. So what we are supposed to do is, even with the New Companies Act, when we say we need to increase the powers of the regulators so that they can take certain actions in time, and they should stop these type of activities when you are increasing and extending the spot rate of T plus 2 for T plus 35 or 36, so people are able to make an arbitrage gains as far as the markets are concerned. So this is how the arbitrage happened in this trade, and people made a lot of money, you know, and finally the slips were issued by those warehouses where the product was actually not there. So my point is that when we go for the audit, we also vouch only those receipts. You know, the physical aspect is not possible at every point of time that whether the product is there in the warehouse or not. And the product was actually missing. And that is what went wrong in the case of National Spot Exchange Limited. So the point is that we need to be very particular as far as these regulations are concerned, and regulator is a facilitator at any point of time. But the point is that the clients as well as the regulator, they need to be honest to do the deals. Because if you come to me that you want to deposit 10 lakh rupees cash in my account, and I have a target given from my management that you have to fulfill this target, what term may, so I might move across beyond the limits and try to facilitate you rather than trying to asking you not to get into this type of trade, right? And similarly, another aspect as I'm telling you, the DAPA trade, when the client asks me that sir, I'm going to give you more commission if you please get my trade executed, not on exchange, but at your end, so we also get into that aspect. So my point is that we need to be very much honest as an investor or as a you know, facilitator on the intermediary side, so that we should not get into these type of deals. And last word from my side is that, you know, whenever we talk about the financial crisis, whether it is a crisis of 2008 or whether it is a crisis which could happen at any point of time in any of the market, the basic factor is the greed factor and the mispricing of the assets. So the prices are being fairly valued and there is no mispricing. That is what even Praveen sir said, that you know that regulator is giving you the platform. Now the prices you are going to decide. Now if you decide a 10 rupee pen price to be 100 valued and there is a buyer, then that's okay. So regulator is saying that we have given you the platform, we are not responsible for the pricing part, you decide the price, you have the liquidity, you have that solvency aspect, so you should decide among yourself, and that's how you should take over the prices part. So thank you so much for your time, and then I will be, you know, again join the panel, and if you have any questions, you please put it across. Thank you so much.